Hello and welcome to Better Weathersfield. My name is Michael Bazzano. Today I have the privilege of interviewing Howard Schwartz. Howard has quite the distinguished resume. He was raised in Montreal and is a correspondent anchorman for 15 years. He's won several national journalism awards for his work in television and has an advanced certification from the National Public Information Officers Association. But today what we're going to be talking to Howard about is his affiliation with Better Business Bureau. So Howard, thank you for coming on the program.
My pleasure.
Really appreciate it.
Nice to meet you.
Likewise. So my first question, when prepping for this interview, I asked a lot of people about Better Business Bureau, and by and large, the general consensus was, well, it's a government agency that helps out the consumer, blah, blah, blah. But it's not a government agency.
It's not. Mm-hmm. It's a non-for-profit, and there are Better Business Bureaus across the country. Some states may have two or three. We cover the entire state of Connecticut. And the reason that people think that we are a governmental agency is because we intervene sometimes. We try and solve disputes for people, but we also do investigations to find evidence or to track or monitor marketplace trends, or if we see any evidence of wrongdoing, and that sometimes involves criminal activity. But people are not obliged to answer Better Business Bureau complaints. As you know, we have accredited businesses, known as members to some people, and we have non-accredited businesses. And what we've done is we have reports, and they're called business reviews. And before you deal with a charity or a business or an individual, we recommend you go to the website just to check the reliability report to see what other consumers' experiences have been like, whether they filed complaints, the types of complaints they filed, and you can even actually read transcripts of what they're saying. But it's interesting that people think we're a government agency because here in Connecticut, we began a century ago as an advertising vigilance organization. And that's something we continue to do to this day. So I think there's been a shift in the paradigm and in the way people look at BBB. And we've evolved from the standpoint that if you ask most people about us, they'll say, well, yeah, BBB is a place where you go to file a complaint. And Better Business Bureau still does handle complaints. But we've also evolved to educate consumers and business owners as well. And coming on shows like this, for example, we can get the word out not only about the services we have, but some of the issues facing consumers on a day-to-day basis and that we're going to see going through certainly this decade and decades ahead.
Well, well stated. Couple facts, as you mentioned, on the Better Business Bureau. Excuse me, Better Business Bureau without
right.
the. Founded in 1912, as you mentioned. Start with trust is the motto, and I think that is very it's very simple and to the point, and it really it describes best what you guys do, and that is you have a very unique position in America and Canada, because you are in both countries, to really act as, again, not a government agency but a nonprofit who is not necessarily a consumer watchdog but an intermediary between businesses and consumers. And a lot of people think that you're just a consumer watchdog, but could you go into detail a little bit about the relationship you play between the businesses and the consumers?
Sure. When a business, by the way, businesses do not apply to become accredited by Better Business Bureau. They have to be invited to do so. And that involves a thorough background check, a transparency check. We check their advertising, those types of things. And what we do is we're trying to foster, and it's interesting you bring up the motto, start with trust, because we're trying to foster a marketplace where buyers and sellers can trust each other. And trust is really a currency now, and it's very difficult to earn, it's very easy to lose. And I think that when we're faced with a situation with the online choices that we have, for a lot of people it boils down to how inexpensive can I get this for? But there are the larger problems of, can I trust this person? Am I going to lose my personal information? Am I going to have my credit card numbers compromised? Those types of things. So that's extremely important. And as far as this acting as a middleman or a mediator, if you will, it's a daunting process sometimes, or a task or attempt for people to try and get settlement if they have a dispute, whether it's with a garage around the corner or the major retailer. You can go to small claims court. If that's warranted, you can go to the Department of Consumer Protection or the Attorney General. But we've got to understand that there are two types of entities when we're talking about fraud or talking about businesses. There are the identifiable ones, and there are the ones who come into town, try to make a quick buck, often unethically, and then they leave. And that becomes a little more of a problem for us, and that's where law enforcement would come in. But Better Business Bureau does give people a place to go to say, listen, I think that I've been treated unfairly. Can you help me? And if it's an accredited business, they are obliged to respond to that complaint, or they'll have their accreditation pulled. Sometimes we are successful at resolving a dispute. Sometimes the consumer doesn't like the way it turned out. Sometimes you don't hear back from them. Sometimes they're a lot of times they're very grateful for the help. And it's also good for businesses. It's a set of checks and balances in a world where so many transactions are not made face-to-face anymore, over the telephone, online, and there's so many people who are trying to invade our lives and get our personal information.
Absolutely. And I want to touch on some of those scams and situations as we move forward. But first, I want to touch on your career. You have a very distinguished background in journalism. In 2008, you became the face of the Connecticut Better Business Bureau. It seems to me you have a ton of passion for what you do and the agency in which you work. What drew you to Better Business Bureau initially?
No one's ever asked me that before, except when I was hired. Mm-hmm. When I was a reporter, I had this feeling, I had a soapbox, not for any particular issue, but because I liked, you know, when there was an issue that an individual was having a problem with an institution, I liked to get on the soapbox and help them out, not preach to anybody. And later on, I became a medical correspondent, and my feeling was, if 750,000 people are watching this newscast and one of them goes to the doctor to get a checkup and we prevent a heart attack in one person, then it was worth it. And when I was faced with what did I want to do when I moved to the United States and I saw the opportunity to work for Better Business Bureau, it was a very good fit because, again, helping people, educating them, getting the word out, and I was really calling upon skills that I used as a journalist and that you use as a host, and that is speak to people, explain things clearly, because there is so much to learn these days. It's a complicated marketplace, and people are understandably frightened.
That is a very comprehensive explanation. I appreciate that. Better Business Bureau provides free business reviews on more than 4 million businesses and over 123 million consumer requests in 2013. That's a staggering number. Another thing that I picked up from people is they tended to think that Better Business Bureau is one location, the base is in Arlington, Virginia. But in actuality, there are Better Business Bureaus all over the country in the U.S. and Canada.
That's crazy.
This is something I think people should be aware of, because if they have an issue, what better agency to go to than you guys?
The Council of Better Business Bureaus, which you mentioned, is in Virginia, in Arlington. It's a franchise, if you will, mm-hmm. but a very strictly controlled one, because we want to make sure the quality is there, and that when a consumer comes to the Better Business Bureau site in Connecticut or any other part of the country, that they get the same kind of information and are treated the same way. So what we're able to do now is we have this network of information where, for example, I will hear from my colleagues elsewhere in the country that there's a scam that's coming this way. And so we're in the unique situation in Connecticut. Connecticut consumers are very savvy, but we give people a heads up so that we don't have as many victims here. And we don't just put out alerts when there are a lot of victims. The hope is that we will prevent these scams from happening. So as far as people who just don't know where to go, we sometimes get calls from folks who never dealt with Better Business Bureau or had heard about us before, and they're very surprised to find out that there is somewhere they can go that can help mediate. Sometimes it's not about going to court or it's not about fighting. It's just, I want to be dealt with fairly. And when you're talking about everything from those very small businesses to the super huge national to multinationals, those can be very, very difficult to deal with. When people file a complaint, they may find that there's a boilerplate kind of answer. People like to feel like they're being addressed individually. You can't do that all the time, but anyone who's ever suffered for a long period of time with customer service trying to resolve what appears to be at face value a very basic complaint, they'll turn to us to get resolution.
Well, I think that the respect that you give those individuals goes a long way toward helping our capitalistic system from devolving into chaos. If there wasn't Better Business Bureau, people might resolve these issues on their own, and that could lead to a situation which would be very hazardous to all involved. going back to what you mentioned before, as far as scams, right now in the state of Connecticut, 2015, what do consumers need to be looking out for in terms of scams
at this point? Well, if we look at the Federal Trade Commission's list of top reported scams for last year, right at the top, and it's not a surprise, is identity theft. And I think there are so many ways that we can have our personal information not only stolen, but misused and abused. And I think right now, everybody's worried because of these data breaches we've seen. There are things that are within our control, and then there are things that are not within our control. Within our control, we can be careful with our credit cards. We learned from the data breaches, don't use a debit card for common purchases, because when you're using a debit card, that money comes straight out of your bank account. And if you get the money back, it's going to take a while, as opposed to a credit card where it's someone else's dime. So these are things that we can do to change our own behavior. But when you're talking about the theft of 80 million records from an insurance company, that affects not only people who are insured, but their kids, their spouses, and all sorts of people. Now we're talking about a whole different level. Having your credit card number stolen is one thing, you're covered for that. But when somebody gets hold of your date of birth and your telephone number, your social security number, and all that other private information, they can virtually become you. They can get a driver's license, they can go for a passport, they can get a loan. And we haven't yet seen we haven't even seen the first shoe drop after this data breach. And a lot of folks were worried that this tax season we were going to see a huge spike in income tax fraud, identity fraud, where people will file a tax return and claim your refund. But the numbers are they're high because that's a terrible crime that's increasing. But we're waiting to see what happens when all of this information that was stolen from the insurance company goes onto the black market. When is it going to hit and where? Because when you're talking about 80 million records, now, they never said if it was 80 million records or people, you're talking about a significant chunk of the American population.
80 million. That's the figure. That's astounding to me.
It's astounding and it's frightening. And usually, and it's very interesting, that a lot of the scams, I'll go online and find out how they're perpetrated, simply because, not to teach people how to do it, but you want to understand to protect yourself and to really boil it down for people. And what I learned is when information is stolen, one of the first places that law enforcement will find it is on the dark side of the internet. They'll find it on sites where people buy and sell information and credit cards, like so much soda pop. And when those credit card numbers start appearing and people are selling a gold card for $50 because they want to get rid of it, then they know that the stolen information is being used.
Wow, that's very understandable. Now, with what you said before mentioning these scams, are there any type of typical scams that everyone should be aware of? Senior citizens, younger folks, are there any that right off the bat you can identify and say, all right, let's stay away from that because that's no good?
Yeah. A lot of it, let's talk about the psychology of the victims and the psychology of the scammers. We would think that probably the elderly are the prime targets of scams. They are certainly a large percentage of the targets. But young people, college-age students, are increasingly becoming targets because it's the old, it cannot happen to me. So they'll do things like they'll lend a debit card and give their PIN number to a friend or a dorm roommate.
Whatever. Oh, boy.
and that's not on the very dumb end of things. But we also see situations where they don't log off of computers, where they do things they should be using a secure connection for, and they don't. So the kinds of things that affect college students, let's think in terms of having important information, papers, bills stolen from their dorm room, having information taken from their computer, or having their information intercepted. Let's go to the other side of the spectrum where we're talking about the elderly. There are a specific set of, let's say that there are really only about five or six scams, they're just variations of them. And the elderly, in many cases, the perception of them is that they have a nest egg, that it's easily available to the scammers, and that they're easily fooled out of their money. And I think before we go any further, I want people to understand that people who become victimized, whether it's the grandparent scam or someone knocking at your front door, these are not stupid people. The folks who are doing these crimes are sophisticated, they can be very intelligent, very persistent, and they're very good at what they do. So at this time of year, for example, with the elderly, we have situations where somebody will drive by their home and they'll say, well, you've got a damaged roof because of the blizzards. Let me go up there and take a look. They'll go on the roof, yank off a shingle, bring it down, and say, well, you know, if you give me a deposit now, I'm going to come because you need to get this fixed right away. Those are the type of predatory things we see with the elderly. But now let's talk about the circle that encompasses baby boomers, the elderly, and young people. Our primary threats come by the telephone, the front door, and the internet, email, and on websites. So let's start right away. Telephones are a big problem because the elderly, we're brought up in a generation where we're taught you don't hang up the telephone on someone. You don't slam the door in their face. And goodness knows, sometimes you want to do that. But there are so many scams that involve the telephone. You have imposter scams. Let's start off with income tax. People from the claiming they're from the IRS will even make what appears to be the Internal Revenue Service number come up in your caller ID. And they'll quote a badge number. They'll say that you owe money and that if you don't pay up right away, that you'll have someone come and arrest you. And people respond to that. Fear is one of the biggest tools that the scammers have. And when we're talking about the scammer psychology, they prey upon our fears, upon our sense of generosity, and our sense of urgency. So the telephone calls are a problem. We've seen situations where someone claiming to be a bailiff will contact you and say, we are going to arrest you unless you pay up money.
Wow.
We see the scams where they will call up. The robocalls, you know, Mike, I get the most questions when we do presentations about what are we going to do about these robocalls? When will they end?
Mm-hmm.
And you get a call from someone claiming they're from cardholder services. Goodness knows I've had a bunch. And they will try and sell you credit repair. They will try and sell you virtually anything. So the telephones are a big deal. And before we move on to internet, I think that it's important everybody put their telephone numbers on the do not call list. And it's very easy. It's donotcall.gov. And we encourage people to go directly to the website. Don't click on a link to get there. Mm-hmm. And we'll get to that. And people will say, but I'm still getting robocalls. What getting on the do not call list does is two things. It significantly does reduce the number of legitimate marketing calls, but also gives you a place to report the criminals who are not smart enough to hide their identification on your caller ID. And by the way, caller ID, unfortunately, is not reliable anymore. You might have heard of the scam where you get a phone call supposedly from yourself on the caller ID, and that's because the same computers that are dialing your number, they know your number, and they'll put it up for you.
I had a friend the other day that happened to her, and she couldn't get over it. She's like, how did my own number appear on here? How did that occur? And that seems to be a new approach by these organizations, and I use that term loosely, in order to dupe people out of their money. So it's a great point you made. You have to be very vigilant about who you're talking to on the phone and how you verify who you're actually talking to.
And if my phone rings and people say, well, what do? I let it go to voicemail. If I don't know who the person is and they really, really want to get hold of me, they'll leave a message. And it's a sad situation. But the technology is coming now. It's starting to, and the Federal Trade Commission and the Federal Communications Commissions are having contests with cash prizes for people who come up with technology to block these robocalls. Mm-hmm. They've already awarded some. Mm-hmm. People who get their telephone service over the internet have free tools available to them to screen out some of those robocalls and stop them. The problem with cell phones and the phones that we have at home is the technology is old, and it's going to be more challenging to try and fix that problem. And then we get after the telephone and someone showing up at your front door, many scams happen there. And the best piece of advice I can give people is don't do business at your front door. Or if somebody leaves a flyer or puts their name on a bulletin board, if you are interested in what they've got to sell, take the information and say, thanks, let me check into it. But I think one of the, to answer your question again about what should we be most worried about, it's fine print. Nobody likes to read it. And I was astounded when I read fine print for an app that I was going to download, and if I can tell you a little bit about it.
Oh, absolutely.
This was an application that was supposed to do one thing and one thing only, and that was if I had any duplicate contacts, it was going to take them out. So I start reading before I clicked to download, reading the terms and conditions. And what this app wanted was the ability to check my email currently and when I'm logged off and any time in the future.
Wow.
They reserved the right to scan the email's sender and their signature. So they would now have the name of the contact, their email, the phone number, the whole thing. And I'm saying this is just, if you hook up to social media, through this app, then it's going to have access to your information there as well. So I'm thinking this was located 4 pages in out of 12, which isn't bad, but at least they told me there was disclosure. And I decided not to download the app, and I got rid of a whole bunch of other ones. Free isn't free. But we've got to do this for contracts and other things. And some folks will make the argument, it's 35 pages of legalese. How am I to get through that? And this is something that regulators are going after very aggressively. Fine print, for those of us over the age of 30, it seems to be getting finer. And when you're talking about a computer screen as well, disclosure is so important, mm-hmm. and we've got to start doing that. This applies also for things like free trials. I can't tell you how many people will sign up for a free trial, for example, or a discount on cable television or a satellite or what have you. And then after 3 months, they're surprised that they're being billed at a higher price for subsequent service. They didn't read the terms and conditions. So before you download anything for free or sign any contract, you really should know everything that you can, because you don't want to get caught in a position where you can't cancel a contract or there are heavy financial penalties.
So does Better Business Bureau, do you offer any services in terms of discerning whether something is credible or not with that legalese, as you mentioned, or if not, is something like that being developed at this time? Because it seems to me there's a lot of demand for safeguarding things such as you said with those long contracts. Is anything like that being developed right now, or is that what Better Business Bureau is doing actively?
We encourage our accredited businesses and all businesses in Connecticut to be transparent. And it's not just us. This is an issue that's come up time and time again at the federal level. You should not be hiding behind 35 pages of legalese. It's not. It should not be designed or written for a lawyer. It should be for folks like you and me who just want to understand what we're getting into. Mm-hmm. So I think we are going to see some changes within the next year or two, especially, again, because people are having, it is a big consumer problem, getting into problems, and then the folks who they're having the dispute with will say, it was in the terms and conditions, you just didn't read them. And that's not best marketplace practice.
No, absolutely not. You mentioned before about certain times of the year, different scams pop up, they're more prevalent. We're moving into the spring season, we're moving into the warmer months now in Connecticut. Thankfully, the snow's melting a little bit. You're from Montreal, so I know that doesn't affect you as much. But what are some of the seasonal scams that occur? What should people be looking out for in the next few months as the weather gets warmer?
Great question. Right mm-hmm. now, we have to watch for folks to come around and tell us that our roof needs repair, or they want to inspect it for us, or they see a shingle off the roof. First thing you should do, call your insurance company. And don't let anyone go up there unless you've chosen them. Mm-hmm. That's typically as the snow starts to melt. And you have basements flooding. You have a year-round scam, but with the change of season, and that's inspecting chimneys and inspecting furnaces. And this is why you have to get several bids when you're doing these kinds of things. As we move into the warmer months, we see one of them is called a paving scam. Someone rings your doorbell and says, we have some asphalt left over from a job down the street or elsewhere in the neighborhood. We can cut you a really good deal. Would you like it? And either if they do any kind of work and don't just walk away with your deposit, they often use substandard material. I don't know about you, I don't want leftovers from someone else's property. Mm-hmm. Or you'll get sprouts coming up through the driveway the next year. And police aggressively go after these folks when they go from one street to another.
So if I may interject, sure. This is, if you will, a pyramid scheme. A lot of companies that are not legitimate will send people out door to door to say, hey, we're checking on some roofing today. Would you like a free quote? Is that more or less what you're talking about, or is that one factor in these scams?
We're talking usually about one individual, one or two. They, in fact, every year the Attorney General and the Secretary of the State hand out millions of dollars of fines to people who come over the border and are not registered to do business in the state of Connecticut. So it does run the gamut, but when you're talking about this type of scheme, it tends to be smaller. When you have a larger business, the hope is, even with a small business, that they'll be honest about it. But we get all kinds of complaints, and I think people should understand, because there's a registration number on the side of the truck or a fancy business card or a fancy website, that does not mean that the company is legitimate. And as we move into summertime, we get the magazine scams. A student shows up on your door, and he or she may indeed be putting themselves through school, but what they may not know is that they're the unwitting dupe of someone they're working for who's around the corner in a van collecting credit card numbers and checks. So we've got to be very careful. And on the issue of magazine sales, though this is not one of the top rated areas of complaint, we get a lot of complaints from people who, when they do these, don't get magazines they ordered, they get magazines they didn't order, or they get nothing at all. Mm-hmm. And the recommendation would be, if you want a subscription, go straight to the magazine's website. Again, the front door is not the greatest place to make a decision.
Okay, well, thank you for that explanation. I hope a lot of viewers took that to heart and will certainly put that into practice. Be careful when anyone's coming to your door and calling you on the phone. I mean, really, we have to be vigilant. I'd be remiss if I didn't touch upon this. The Better Business Bureau is private, nonprofit. There has been some controversy regarding this term "pay to play." Mm-hmm. If a business does not register with Better Business Bureau, they receive a lower grade in some cases. I guess Wolfgang Puck had a problem with this years ago. Ritz-Carlton. How do you refute those claims that Better Business Bureau is merely trying to profit upon themselves by selling these registrations to different businesses?
It's a fair question. We're not selling registration to these businesses. And a lot of this started with one Better Business Bureau that was not following the rules that the rest of us followed. And the allegation came up that they had sold BBB accreditation to Hamas, which we know is a terrorist organization, basically to show that someone was not watching the shop. But there were allegations that this BBB in particular, not ours, but one out west, was also telling people, well, you've got a C rating. If you want to get up to an A or an A+, we can help you with that. Join Better Business Bureau. And that's unethical from A to Z. And if you want to start with trust, that's not something you should be doing. People in Connecticut, Better Business Bureau in Connecticut, and no others that I can, all the others I can think of, have never, do not, and will not accept money for a higher letter grade. Mm-hmm. And I think it speaks to the ethical practices that a company that's not accredited can get an A+. And there are companies that are accredited that are not eligible because they either haven't been in time long enough in business or for a variety of other reasons. And it's not a penalty, it's just that you need to establish a business record over a couple of years. So the notion of selling ratings is repugnant. And it's something that bothered all of us, and it rightfully should have been addressed, and that BBB was removed from the system, and rightfully so.
Well, I think that's a good explanation. The bottom line is, when you have an organization as large as Better Business Bureau, there are going to be instances where you have a few rogue elements doing things that are unethical. That's to be expected. So that's a very fair answer, and I certainly thank you for that. Regarding the advancement in this state for consumer protection, the next 15, 20 years, do you have any prognostication for what scams are on the horizon and how we can combat them going forward, looking about, like I said, about 15, 20 years down the line?
That's interesting. That's mm-hmm. a long timeline considering how fast things happen. Mm-hmm. When I was preparing to come here today, I was looking at an article that said, what can we expect in 2015 alone in terms of cybercrime and other types of fraud? I think it's so difficult to even look at what's going to happen at the end of this year. Mm-hmm. I'm not dodging your question, mm-hmm. but when we have people saying, my information is not safe anymore. When will they roll out the secure credit cards, the ones with the little chips in them? Mm-hmm. When are the merchants going to be held accountable, or the banks held accountable, or the insurance company that had those records stolen? And I think we won't hear about what the security experts, government, and everyone else is doing to secure it. Sometimes we don't hear about the breaches either. So a lot of what's going to happen in the next year, and we can look that far ahead, is there'll be some, hopefully, locking of the doors that are being opened, but also a change in the way we pay for things. We know that there's a smartphone maker that wants you to pay with your smartphone. We have a variety of ways of paying, online payment methods and whatnot, but it's going to have to be secured. A simple login and password is not safe enough anymore. Those electronic chip cards, which cannot be reproduced, I think they are mandated to be rolled out nationally by the fall. And you'll find them in other countries. In Canada, you'll find them in Europe as well. We need that. We can't afford anymore. And businesses, it's not only a question of losing money. It's a question of reputation. And I can tell you from a store that was down the street from where I used to work, they had their terminals hacked somehow. And everybody loved the store. They loved the owner and the people who worked there. But I wouldn't be telling you the truth if I said that they had business as usual for the next several months after. And it wasn't the grocery store's fault. Mm-hmm. So as for what's going to happen for consumer protection for the next 15 years, we're still, in a sense, playing catch-up. Consumer legislation in Connecticut is excellent, probably among the best in the country. And that's laudable. And so much more is being done. We have a new commissioner of the Department of Consumer Protection, Attorney General Jepson, also been doing wonderful jobs. So what happens is, I foresee when we start seeing, and this is unfortunate, but it's always we're playing catch-up. Consumer legislation that we might see in Connecticut would mirror what's going on at the federal level. And, for example, we were talking about disclosure and things like that. But it's also to protect consumers from differences in the way that we are marketed to and advertised to. And this has become a big deal, truth in advertising. You see claims for, and in fact, the Federal Trade Commission today said that it's fined a company more than $7 million for false advertising, using deceptive advertising about a free trial. Mm-hmm. We see that left, right, and center, and I can give you another example. Better Business Bureau has just updated its code of advertising. And this basically lays out what is good marketplace practice or not for any kind of business. Well, we had to update that to bring it in line with the fact that we have internet and we have all these other venues and vectors for getting to us. We had to update that. We see that there are pieces of federal legislation that had to be updated to take internet into account because it only affected mail that we received by the U.S. Postal Service. And then there's the whole question of the internet, and because we didn't really touch on the dangers there. I think that this also might come within regulation as to how well we're protected. And the reason I mention this is because from Better Business Bureau's, the way we operate, if you have a problem with a company that's headquartered out of the state, we will automatically route that complaint to the state where the company is based. When you're faced with a situation that you are at the end of your rope, where you are simply not getting the information you need and is being withheld, well, that's a call for regulation. That's a call to step up and fix things. And I think that we've got to look at the internet from, this is not a dangerous place, it's a wonderful place, but we're taught when we're kids not to get into cars with strangers. And to hearken back to what you and I just discussed at the very beginning, consumer behavior to a large extent determines whether or not we become victims. And if we talk about email and the internet, a couple of simple rules can protect us from virtually all fraud, and they're all behavior-based. Number one, email. It may look like it's coming from the Internal Revenue Service. Goodness knows how many fake emails I've gotten from government agencies, and they look wonderful. One of them is actually addressed to Dear Costumer. It wasn't Dear Consumer or Customer. And this is from the Internal Revenue Service, supposedly.
Costumer.
Costumer.
Costumer, okay.
We get those, and people get frightened, and they'll mm-hmm. click on a link. Mm-hmm. Your bank account's been frozen. Click on this link to update your information. Mm-hmm. If you click on a link that you don't know, it can either take you to a lookalike bank site or government site, ask for your personal information, and then it's gone. Or it can download malware onto your computer. And, in the old days, we had to worry about spam and a simple virus. So that people understand really what the danger is for themselves and to explain to the rest of their family, malware now features what's called a keylogger. And what that means is once this is burrowed into your computer because you clicked on a rogue link, it captures every website you go to and everything you type on your keyboard. So if they see Howard's going to John's bank, his password, his login is Howard Schwartz, and his password is I like to be safe online. They will see all of that as I type it out on the keyboard. Mm-hmm. So be careful what you click on. The keystroke loggers, once they're in, they're very hard to detect. Be careful on Wi-Fi, wireless Wi-Fi where no passwords required. If you're doing banking, if you're going to be doing your social media, people can hack into that as well. And finally, there's the area of how do you get to a site? What do scammers try to do to get us to click on nasty links? They appeal to our sense of interest in the macabre. So, for example, when somebody dies, mm-hmm. in the case of Robin Williams, there was a link going around saying, click here to see crime scene photos. Click here to see pictures of Osama bin Laden, those types of things. And people do want to see sensational pictures and footage. But there'll be more subtle things like on Facebook or any social medium, it might say, well, there's this video of you that I think you'd want to see. And it may even have your friend's name on it. You click on it, and either you get that nasty software downloaded or goodness knows what. Be careful what you click, and remember, and this is probably the most important thing you and I can discuss tonight, and that is between the telephone and email, government and financial institutions will never initiate contact with you by telephone or by email on the internet. That's very important to remember.
So the government, when they need to reach out, they will do it via mail, never email, and never phone. Is that correct?
They will never initiate it. That's correct.
Never initiate it. Okay.
If you call them and you've got a problem, but why that's important is because people will panic. Again, the sense of fear. The IRS is calling me saying that I didn't do something. We had a situation last year, which you probably remember, where people were claiming they were from the public utility, from CLNP, saying, we will turn off your power unless you pay us.
Yeah.
It stands to reason. A lot of people responded very quickly. So just slow down and think a little bit. And yes, a government will never, and the IRS thing, for example, remember that if there's a problem with your tax return, they will send you a formal letter and you have the opportunity to respond to it. They're never going to call you up and just threaten to toss you in the slammer or send police after you.
Well, that's certainly very valuable advice. A lot of the advice we've heard today has been very valuable. Is there anything else before we wrap it up that you'd like to get across to the viewers? Anything in particular as a final just declaration of this is what you should do, this is how you should think? Is there anything else you'd like to tell the viewers before we exit the interview?
Sure. Mm-hmm. One of the tools we talked about that the scammers use is they try to appeal to our generosity. Mm-hmm. And we see after every kind of tragedy, whether man-made or natural, that scammers set up fundraising websites. And some people have very good intentions to create these charities, but they may not have the experience to receive and distribute the money properly. Mm-hmm. We encourage, you want to help out, that's fine. Wait a few days to find out whether City Hall or a bank has arranged to accept donations. And BBB, it's not just businesses. We have reports on charities as well. We have 20 standards of charity accountability that talks about everything from governance to how many cents per dollar go towards administration. And these are important things that you want to know. So I'm mentioning the charities because that is something that people say, well, you know, I know this charity, but there are a lot of look-alike names, sound-alike names, mm-hmm. and links to fake charities. So just be careful what you click. If somebody calls you up and you don't know them, hang up the phone. You don't have to be mean about it.
So it's okay to be generous, just be smart, is really what you're saying.
You don't want people to be victimized twice, once by whatever the tragedy was, and the second way by not receiving the money that they can use so desperately.
Excellent. Well, Howard, I really appreciate you coming on. Again, folks, Howard Schwartz of Better Business Bureau of Connecticut, giving us a lot of great advice here. I hope you were paying attention and taking notes. I've certainly learned a lot. So, sir, I thank you for coming on today. I really appreciate
it. Thank you, Mike. I enjoyed it.
All right. Excellent. Hopefully we'll have you on in the future if all things go well. We'd like to thank you for taking the time to watch our show today. Again, this is Better Weathersfield. My name is Michael Bazzano. And we will see you next time. Thank you.